सो टुडे ओके सो टुडेज थीम इज ऑफ द डेटा साइंस एंड आई विल बी टॉकिंग यू नो फ्यू एस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ डेटा साइंस विद फ्यू एग्जांपल्स एंड देन आई विल बी टॉकिंग अबाउट सम ऑफ द इम्प्लीमेंटेशन थ्रू आर्टिफिशियल इंटेलिजेंस एंड मशीन लर्निंग. सो या टू स्टार्ट विथ या आई मीन यू नो इन लॉट ऑफ फ्यूज इवेंट्स सिंगल डे इवेंट्स और सिंपोजियम डेटा साइंस हैज बीन डिस्कस्ड अ लॉट बट टू स्टार्ट विथ आई वुड लाइक टू गिव सम डेफिनेशन ऑफ द डेटा साइंस. सो व्हाट इज डेटा साइंस? सो डेटा साइंस इज द स्टडी ऑफ डेटा ओके दैट इन्वॉल्व डेवलपिंग मेथड फॉर रिकॉर्डिंग स्टोरिंग एंड एनालाइजिंग डेटा टू इफेक्टिवली एक्सट्रैक्ट द यूजफुल इंफॉर्मेशन. हेलो या सो व्हाट इज डेटा साइंस? सो डेटा साइंस इज बेसिकली द एप्लीकेशन फॉर द साइंटिफिक मेथड ऑफ द डेटा. सो वी हैव द टेस्टेबल हाइपोथेसिस वी हैव द रिप्रोड्यूसेबल डिजाइन वी हैव द कंट्रोल एंड वी नीड द पॉजिटिव आउटकम बेस्ड ऑन द एक्सपेरिमेंट दैट वी आर कंडक्टिंग. बट the data science is based on the data. So data is our reagent okay and data science is about making sure that we have the right data, it is not contaminated or expired, and we are using them in the well designed experiment. Data science, if we talk about the data science applications, we can segregate it in four major categories. The statistical applications. So widely used statistical application is SAS in most of the clinical trials or the data analytics. Now there is a R language which is extremely popular to analyze the data and which has a vast library of open source statistical packages. Tableau is another program for visualizing the data, which is being used by the businesses or the academicians and journalists and etc. All other different kind of professions. So statistical applications basically focus on the analysis and allow us to do the powerful things. Kind of you know running regressions or visualizing the data etc. Business intelligence. So business intelligence is are again the statistical tools that are focused on creating the dashboard, so which can be used specifically in drug discovery by the clinicians or the data management or the pharmacovigilance team. To visualize the data and based on that, you know, have more insight into the data and draw some conclusions or draw some actionable items. Data mining. So we have the statistical applications or the tools. We have the dashboard. Now, data mining is about predicting the future trends and behavior based on the past data, based on the based on the statistics that we are generating by using the statistical applications and the business intelligence tool. Okay. And the fourth aspect is about the data collaboration. Okay. So this is another space that is likely to be more important in future as the companies are building the large data science teams. R Studio, for an example, offers the tools for data scientists. To build a lightweight ad hoc app that can be shared with the team and helps non-data scientists also to investigate the data. So, science applications that are there. We think about the data science. So,
Sugam, can you speak
in general, like when I compared the data, yeah.
Hello.
Yeah, now it's
Hello. Fine. Can you is this fine?
Closer to the mic. Yeah.
So when I think of you know, the clinical trials that we are doing on a regular basis, and when I look at the real world evidence studies, probably you know what I got is as a data as an input, data as an output in the randomized clinical trial. So we have a well designed trial design. We have a well designed protocol, which has been reviewed by the regulatory and ethical bodies. You know, and then we move forward with the actual operation for the clinical trial. That clinical operations generate the data, raw data, that is the and that we use for the analysis purpose, which we can use for the publications or the CSR. When I look at the real world evidence study, which is kind of a data as an input, so there are different data sources that are available, like from the FDA or from the health records or from the past historical data for a particular molecule, that is available, readily available. So we process that, we take that data, we process that data, okay, by using machine learning or natural processing, because that data can be unstructured. Okay, what we need to work on the data is would need to do is to work on the data, get you know the data as per the requirement, which can then be used to draw the conclusion and get more insights about a particular molecule. So that's how you know the difference in the data as a input and the data as an output. So when I talked about the data as the input, okay, so there could be structured data and then the unstructured data. The structured data, when we think about the clinical trial, it can be CRF. There is a definite questions that have been asked. There is a database developed. Okay, so that's an EDC data. There is a vendor data which we which can be captured in a specific fashion, and which can be
Sugam, there is an interruption, so we can't hear you. No. We can't hear you, Sugam. Can you just adjust your audio connections?
You are able to hear me now?
Yes, now it's better.
Yeah. Hello.
Keep the mic closer to your...
I was talking about the unstructured data. Yeah. So I was talking about the unstructured data. Okay, so which can be in the form of text or which can be in the form of images. So the typical applications that we can use is natural languages, and the examples are like report or the images or the physician's note, etc. So there is a lot of unstructured data when we think about the registry studies or real world evidence studies, and so that data we need to use, and we need to get as per the requirement, and then we need to process it to get more insights about that particular data. So there is a lot of unstructured data which can be which is available that we need to process. So that is the difference between, you know, what is the data science do and what we in the clinical trial are currently doing. So there is a data, and so there is a classic study or the case studies that I have come across when I was researching for this particular presentation. So when we think about the data analysis, so let me take an example. Okay, So suppose there is a research conducted on the gemology, and we want to investigate the influence of the sport or the exercise that we do on a weekly basis on the lung functionality. Okay. Now, outcome of the interest, and when we measure the lung function, which is generally been determined as spirometry and provided by the FEV1. Okay, so that is the forced expiratory volume in 1 second. So that is what our outcome of interest. So there is a definite sample or the population that we are looking at. Okay, so that cohort may not have the outliers or may not have the missing values when we collect the data, and those patients are within some range of the output values. Okay, when we analyze the data, we tend to look at the lot of other aspects like demographic characteristics or their smoking their smoking habits, or whether the patients have asthma, or whether they have been exposed to environmental population, and etc. When we compare or when we take these particular variables into consideration, there could be yes or no for this continuous variable. So we are comparing the cohort which is smoking or have asthma or exposed against not to have, whether they are not smoking or don't have asthma or not exposed to environmental population. So we perform the linear regression, and we create the coefficients which will be compared according to their magnitudes to discuss the different influences. Okay, so that's the classical approach. Now there is a data set. Okay, so in contrast to the classical approach, in which everything is a well-defined and pre-selected. Okay, the data science approach is more open. Though the formulated question is the same, but we tend to include all the variables, and the population may not be stratified. Okay, so for an example, if I'm talking about a chronic kidney disease and people whose kidney stopped working and who need the renal replacement, and some of the patients after the initiation of therapy, they died. Okay, but we don't have the full understanding of what has happened, or investigating the mortality of the patient is a big task. Okay, maybe the treatment process is not optimized, or maybe the treatment process may be the patient dependent. Okay, but the data science idea is to develop a model with few uncorrelated variables as possible while still keeping the model performance. Okay, so some data about demographics or treatment parameters or the lab values for each patient is available at the time as a time series. So usually such questions are answered by using the Kaplan-Meier for survival analysis methods. But here what we are doing is we are looking at the data. Okay, we are looking at all the variables which may be correlated or uncorrelated, and then we are using, or then we are developing the model, okay, based on which we can run or do the analysis, and then check the model performance, and then make certain conclusions or have the actionable items.
Sugam, sorry to interrupt, you have another 5 minutes.
Pardon?
You have another 5 minutes.
Hello?
Sugam, can you hear me?
Oh, okay.
You have last 5 minutes.
Yes, yes, I can hear you. Oh, okay. So when we think about the success factors of the clinical trial, definitely the trial design is the first and foremost important factor, okay, in defining the success. And around it, you know, once we have the trial design and once we have the protocol accepted, and when we start, you know, actually when the trial is actually operationalized, then there are other aspects like the risk monitoring or the data quality or, you know, drug efficacy. So these are the three aspects which are related to the patients or the operations. These are the 3 points which are related to the data that we are capturing on the studies. As well as there are two factors like time variance and the cost variance based on the enrollment of the patients, based on the efficiency that we are achieving while entering the data, so that the time could be saved, okay, not to resolve the queries and etc. So there can be n number of factors that could be considered while considering the cost variance and time variance, okay. And all these factors are depend on the patient selection, adverse events, and the site selection. So these are the main factors, okay, the success factors for the clinical trial. Now, to make the clinical trial successful, okay, there could be ways to achieve the efficiencies or make a trial successful by using the artificial intelligence or machine learning. Artificial intelligence is a program with the ability to learn and reason like humans. So it's a broad term under which the machine learning, so the algorithms, machine learnings are the algorithms which with the ability to learn without we being explicitly programming those algorithms. And the deep learning is the subset of that machine learning. Okay, so this is the general overview of artificial intelligence and machine learning. The goal is to develop the system which can tackle the complex problem when we are performing the different activities on the clinical trial. Okay, so be it managing and engaging patients, or target identification, or sales and marketing, etc. So some of the initiatives that I would like to talk about is artificial intelligence and machine learning implementation in my organization. Okay, so the initiative is the one of the initiative is site activation and patient enrollment. So what we are doing is we are using the historical data combined with the third party sources to develop the predictive algorithm that forecasts the study level activation and patient. So what value we are adding is you know, which is like this initiative provides the business development the more accurate study timeline during the bidding process and during the bid defense. Also, it provides the project management, the site initiation activities, and clinical study level expectation communication to the sponsor. Okay, it provides the project manager and the clinical study to forecast the accurate study timeline, okay, based on the patient enrollment prediction. Okay, so that's the advantages of this particular initiative. There is an enhanced predicted activation date of site. So again, the PPD, what PPD is using is historical data combined with the third party data sources to forecast the specific sites are expected to activate. Okay, with the ability to reforecast at different site milestones. Okay, so what value this is adding is it will provide the data driven guidance, and you know, it will have the predictive activation date, okay, into the CTMS. If there are any, so we also face, you know, the issues like non-enrolling sites. So there can be, you know, if multiple sites are there and you know, there are issues with some of the sites which are not able to enroll the patient as per expectations. Okay, so again, with the historical data, okay, we can predict the probability of a site will be non-enrolling as they approach the site activation into clinical. So these are some of the initiatives. There are more initiatives like market access, insight, protocol optimization. Now, protocol optimization service, you know, this is a very good initiative, okay, which will help the client to understand the protocol design compared to the others, okay, and you know, which will have the regulatory robustness basically. So you know, I feel, and AE intake automation. So if I relate to what programmers and the statisticians are more interested in is the protocol optimization. So if we have the AI generated data set of protocol information, so that will allow us to quickly benchmark a new protocol design. Okay. So similarly for the AE intake automation, okay. So it will reduce the cycle time from the receipt of the adverse event to initiate the entry into the safety database. Okay. So it will also improve the consistency and reliability of the intake process. So yeah, definitely when there are so many initiatives, definitely those initiatives or machine learning and artificial intelligence, you know, with the help of with the help of the historical data and the vendor data sources will definitely help the organization to improve to help the predictive forecasting and improve the efficiency of the trial. So some of the artificial intelligence which is been implemented in the clinical development you know, in different organizations. So this slides talks about you know, the applications or the artificial intelligence that has been implemented or developed in different pharma companies or different CROs. So there's a NERD Live at Novartis. So this is an advanced analytics platform that brings together the data from close to 500 Novartis studies. So IQVIA has also invested in AI enabled cancer community, that is belong.life. Okay, so Apple has also developed the research kit to enable research conduct studies. And Merck is also leveraging the atom wise AI based technology to scan existing medicine that could be redesigned. So these are the different artificial intelligence tools that that the different organizations are using to improve the development of the molecules, or to improve the clinical operations, or to improve the forecasting, etc. So yeah, so slowly and steadily, definitely all the pharma companies and CROs are implementing different ways of using the artificial intelligence in the clinical development, and we will see that it will be implemented in near future in our programming aspect as well, be it SGTM, ADAM, and TLF. Okay, so currently you know, as per my understanding, we are into automation process, but we have not really into the machine learning where the algorithm itself modifies to as per the data and without having our control. But definitely the industry will be moving, especially the programming will be moving towards it. So that's it from my end, Jay Pandya.